Okay, so classic homework question. Actually, classic exam question. Labeling a replication fork. So let's clear up any problems that you might be having with that. Hi, biology friends. It's Sarah, your other biology professor. Let's label some replication forks. We're going to start with a simple one, with just the DNA strands, making sure we know the names of the strands and the directions. And then we'll add some proteins. Do one that's a little bit more complicated. So if that's what you're looking for, go ahead and skip ahead a bit. Replication forks. So we're talking DNA replication here. Now, in order to replicate the DNA, we've got to separate the two strands of DNA. We've got to break apart the hydrogen bonds that are keeping those complementary base pairs together. Now, there are enzymes that do this part. Once we've got regions of single-stranded DNA that can be read, right, they can be used as a template for building that new strand of DNA, we can start replication. These areas of single-stranded DNA are called replication bubbles. Now, each replication bubble will have two replication forks, one on each side, and replication will occur in both directions into each of those two replication forks. When the replication forks meet up, replication is terminated, and all of our proteins, our replication machinery, disassembles. Replication fork diagrams can vary a little bit, but as long as you know what you're looking for, and I'm here to help with that, you should be okay. So let's draw our own, and at the end, you'll have a nice labeled replication fork that you can work with. On the replication fork, the two DNA strands on the outside are going to be used as the template strands for DNA replication. Now, these strands have directionality, a 5' end and a 3' end. And if that's a little confusing to you, I've got a quick video that clears that all up. Hopefully you remember that paired DNA strands are not just complementary, meaning A pairs with T, G pairs with C, but they're also anti-parallel, which means if one strand runs 5' to 3' in one direction, the paired up strand runs 5' to 3' in the opposite direction. Inside the fork are the new DNA strands being produced. You'll notice that one of them is produced in one long continuous piece. This is the leading strand. It's going to be generated 5' to 3' into the fork. And the other one will be made in little fragments we call Okazaki fragments. This is the lagging strand. But why? Well, when we make a chain of nucleic acids, and this is true for DNA and RNA, our chain can only grow by adding on to the 3' end. So this is where that 3' and 5' becomes really important. The leading strand is oriented 5' to 3' towards the fork, into the fork, which means that as we keep opening up our replication fork more and more, we can just keep replicating straight into it. That's why it's in one continuous piece. The lagging strand is oriented 5' to 3' away from the fork. Now, we can still only add onto that 3' end. So what that means for the lagging strand is that we have to open up the replication fork a good amount, then we can add a little fragment. Then we have to wait for it to open up some more, add a fragment. So back to that idea of anti-parallel strands when we pair them up. Notice how the top template strand has the opposite 5', 3' directionality when we compare it to the leading strand. And the bottom template strand has the opposite 5', 3' directionality when compared to that lagging strand. And remember, for each replication bubble, you've got two replication forks. So you can see that for each fork, you've got a leading strand and a lagging strand, and replication is proceeding in both directions into both forks. So now that we've got that labeled, let's step it up a little bit and add some proteins. I'm sure you will not be at all surprised to know that there are differences between prokaryotic and eukaryotic DNA replication, but the general idea of the process is pretty much the same. Most classes focus on prokaryotic DNA replication, and so that's what we'll use here. All right, so let's label this guy. I'm going to point out some hints for finding certain proteins along your replication fork. They're going to be related to the function of the protein. Hopefully that helps you remember that a little bit better. So at the very beginning, we talked about how we have to separate those DNA strands in order to read them as template strands. And the enzyme responsible for doing this is an enzyme called helicase. On a diagram, you're going to find helicase right in there, right in that fork. And again, its job is going to be to facilitate the breaking of the hydrogen bonds holding our two strands together through complementary base pairing. Now, as those strands separate, as they pull apart a bit, it's going to stress out the still wound up DNA. There are enzymes to help with that too. They are called topoisomerases. Gyrase is a bacterial topoisomerase. And you're going to find that out in the still wound up portion of the DNA to the front of your replication fork, just outside. Now, DNA does not love being single-stranded, right? It's going to want to kind of go back, get those complementary bases back together. That's not really helpful when we're trying to read it as a template. And so there are proteins called single-strand binding proteins, or SSBs, that are going to keep those DNA strands from coming back together. You're going to find these in places where the DNA is still single-stranded. All right, at this point, I hope we can pretty easily label the leading strand, right? Going to be produced in a nice continuous piece, as well as the lagging strand consisting of Okazaki fragments. Both the leading strand and the lagging strand are going to be generated by DNA polymerases. These are enzymes that create polymers of DNA. They take nucleotides and chunk them together to make a big strand. Like eukaryotes, prokaryotes have multiple polymerases as well. For the leading and lagging strand, that synthesis is going to be done by DNA polymerase III. One thing about DNA polymerases is that they can't start a strand from scratch. They can only add on to something that's already there. So you'll notice our Okazaki fragments are kicked off starting with an RNA primer. So it's kind of weird, right? We actually start making DNA by making RNA, but it works. That RNA primer is made by an enzyme conveniently called primase. So wherever you see a primer that looks like it's still in the process of being made, you're going to see a primase enzyme there doing its job. Primase enzymes have RNA polymerase activity, and they're able to start a new strand from scratch. You'll see that in the process of transcription. And yes, the leading strand did indeed start with an RNA primer as well. We just aren't showing it in this diagram. It would have already been removed. Why? Well, if we're making DNA, we don't want RNA in our finished product. So eventually we're going to have to go around, pop those primers out, and fill in the gap that's left with DNA. DNA polymerases are needed here, and in prokaryotes, that is DNA polymerase number one. Well, after all of this removing of RNA primers, building strands, Okazaki fragment building, right? We're gonna be left with some little gaps in our sugar phosphate backbone. Little places where we've got a phosphodiester bond that needs to be generated to stick those guys together. Sugar on one nucleotide to the phosphate on the next. Ligase. We need ligase. Ligase is the enzyme that's going to do that to give us one nice continuous sugar phosphate backbone. So if you see something that looks like it's fixing a hole, or sort of in the final process of connecting two fragments together that are like touching because they're so close and they're done, ligase. Ligase is gonna be there. There's a lot of machinery involved in DNA replication, but hopefully seeing the locations of all of these proteins gives you a better idea of how they fulfill their job in the process of replicating the DNA. And that means you can get points for your own understanding. Drop me a like if you learned something about labeling these replication forks. Subscribe for more biology content from me. Check out my website for tutoring resources, and I'll see you next time.